So the talk was originally supposed to be done by Hans de Graaf, but he emailed me on Friday that he has a family emergency and he had a set of slides almost finished. So we did what we could, but we have the guy here, Diego Perrin, who actually wrote the stuff that we are talking about. So I'm guessing he has enough knowledge to fill in the blanks if the slides are not good enough. For myself, or if you want to introduce ourselves a little bit better, so I'm a Gentoo developer since 05. I don't do Ruby stuff myself, but I sit on the console, do Daryl and recruitment. But let's hand over to Diego, who actually does the Ruby stuff.
Hi-ho, I'm Diego Petena from Gentoo, Flame Eyes. And I take care of Ruby packaging in Gentoo together with Hans and Alex, mostly. And I designed the new way we are using since 2 years ago to package Ruby gems in Gentoo. It is the fake gem method. And, well, we can go on from here.
So how many of you use Gentoo? Most? How many of you know how to write e-builds? Okay. About half. So basically, it's our packaging format. There are shell scripts written in Bash that there was the Debian talk a while ago. You didn't let them make. But so basically, we wrap all the Ruby gem operations in Bash operations. And there's a lot of logic going on that's mostly written in Bash. But we'll get to that once we show actual source code. So the statistics, the support implementations that we have are Ruby 1.8, Ruby 1.9, then JRuby, the Ruby Enterprise Edition, which is 1.8 basically, and Ruby News, but not that many packages for it. So Diego, what is the plan for Ruby 1.9? It's not stable yet, but when would we find it?
We had quite a bit of trouble to get the Ruby 1.9 to work. The main issue has been that while upstream considered it very stable already, a lot of the extensions didn't work with Ruby 1.9. It had to be tested thoroughly one by one. As an example, we found that the FCGI Ruby gem that was supposed to be compatible with Ruby 1.9 from the version you get from Ruby gems, it couldn't be loaded. It will fail to load once you tried, and if you try to execute it anyway, it ended up missing some symbols and closing down your Ruby application altogether. So we had been testing this since about 2010. Should have been May 2010, around that time.
It's not important that.
It's a bit important in the context because we just now have been able to provide Ruby 1.9 unmasked, so for the general availability on Gentoo. It took us 2 years to come to this point. It was a difficult process, and we hope to get it stable during this year. But most of the work has been done. Most of the Ruby gems right now are developed for 1.9, and there aren't so many legacy packages as we had before. And we can probably consider it this the year we can get Ruby 1.9 stable. We have JRuby has been actually updated. It's no longer 1.5 in Gentoo. We have 1.6 since 2 weeks ago about. And we're doing our best to get Ruby, JRuby and Ruby 1.9 to the same coverage as Ruby 1.8. Ruby News has been a very recent addition, so we haven't been able to test much of this. It's mostly a problem with related dependencies. As you'll see later, we have many steps to take to package a Ruby gem in a Gentoo build. So the common problem we have with Ruby gems usually stem from the fact that it's a different world Ruby gems has been designed to work on. Ruby gems is designed to give the developers the latest and the greatest of some code, but we want to give them something stable. So we end up having to integrate dependencies that can't be integrated in Ruby gems. for instance, rmagic, it's a Ruby gem that wraps around image magic for conversion, reduction, resizing. The gem can't tell your package manager that it needs image magic to be present. We can do that in very build, so we have a dependency on it, and we also know that it can't work if HDRI support is enabled. So we can provide that while the gem itself can't. We also have most of the time to apply some patch, either to the gem spec itself or to the gem code. Usually it's a matter of wrong version in the dependencies, wrong version in the library file. Sometimes it can be something worse, like it doesn't work if the file system is case sensitive, because the Ruby gem have been developed and tested only on OS X or Windows, both of which are case insensitive, and the gem will never run on Unix. We have to fix that, or we have to fix our specs so that it knows that if it's trying to find a particular file in the file system, it might be at a different location in Gentoo, because we have side-by-side installation of Ruby 1.8.9, Enterprise, Rubinus, and so on. Plus, gems by themselves usually don't run tests. Gentoo builds can optionally run tests to check whether the code just built, just installed, is working on the system, if the dependencies are all OK, or if there is something wrong with them. Ruby gems has an option to run the tests, but most of the gems out there are not covering the tests. To reduce the size of a gem file, they scratch out most of the test data, most of the test files. Sometimes they keep the test files, but not the test data, so you can't run tests from the gem code alone, even if they are installed. Instead, we run them during the build phase, and then we scratch them. We don't even install them most of the time. There are a few more problems with Ruby gems that don't stem from their design. One obvious thing is there is no validation of the gems that are uploaded on rubygems.org. There is no way to check whether the license is valid, whether the files are all covered by a good license. Lately, Hans has been fighting with Rails upstream because the prototype Rails gem that provides the compatibility layer between Rails 3.2 and Rails 3.1, since, and I don't remember if it's also from 3.0, since the default installed no longer uses prototype but jQuery, and you need to install a separate gem, a separate library for the prototype JavaScript library. But gem doesn't have a license. There is no way to know under which terms prototype is released for that gem. And the result is we are not packaging prototype Rails because we are not sure if we can distribute it. Other things usually come in the form of bugs. As I said, sometimes it's just the library is not designed to work in case of sensitive system, so you have to patch it out. Many other times we have trouble because really the code is not tested, not well tested at least. And we have too much work to do to find out why it doesn't work. And it doesn't work not only in Gentoo, but also in other distributions as well. So we move that to upstream, and we have to skip a release. Some other times, we end up patching it, so we have a fixed version in Gentoo, but we have to wait till upstream release a new one to have it patched already. The end result, not for all packages, but for many, we have to skip one, two versions because we haven't fixed our problems yet. When the user wants to install gems from rubygems.org repository without the validation from Gentoo, without our version restriction, without our tests, in Gentoo, Ruby gems are still usable. They're both usable as system level by using USR local, so that they don't overwrite the stuff installed by Portage or the package manager in general. Or they can be installed in the home directory of the user. So you can still have both the nice things about RubyGems that they just work out of the box, and the packaged version from Gentoo that is tested and usually safe. But later. We have, as I said, multiple implementation in Gentoo of Ruby. We have Ruby 1.8, MRI, the original implementation. Then we have Ruby 1.9. As I said, we have unmasked it less than 2 months ago, because Ruby 1.8 is at its end of life. Starting from June, there won't be any more release. There is no security audit going on with 1.8, so it's totally dead. We are moving to 1.9. We have been very slow to move to 1.9 because we had a lot of trouble with it. Nowadays, it's almost ready, so we are moving to 1.9 just fine. We have both 1.9 and 1.9.2 and 0.3. We also have JRuby for systems that can run Java. It's an implementation of Ruby over Java, supports both 1.8 and 1.9 syntax, and it's much faster in execution, albeit quite slower in runtime. We have the ability for the user to change the default Ruby implementation on the system, so the Ruby command, the IRB command, which Ruby will execute the commands, the scripts installed in US bin. We support using Ruby 1.8 or 1.9 or the Enterprise Edition, although we don't guarantee we'll support Enterprise Edition much longer, because currently there is no security release about it. So it's, we know Ruby Enterprise Edition is currently vulnerable to a few vulnerabilities that were in Ruby 1.8 and were fixed. They are not in Enterprise Edition because the code is diverged. You can still run any of the implementation directly with their name. So Ruby 1.8, Ruby 1.9, JRuby, Ruby 1.9, Ruby AA 1.8. Bless you. And you can continue that way normally. So in Gentoo we have a staged approach to the installation of packages. So we have an unpack phase where the tarball is expanded, a preparation phase where the code is patched, configuration phase where you usually run the .configure script on AutoTools project. You have something similar for Ruby extensions, for Ruby native extensions, since you have an xconf.rb file that is used to generate the make files. Then you have the compile step, but usually for non-native Ruby packages doesn't exist, but there are exceptions, a test phase and an install phase. To handle multiple Ruby implementations, what I designed it to be, we split the step into two main types. You have a singular step that is executed once for each package, and then a per-implementation step that is executed once for each implementation. So there is, in the case of unpack, there is only the all Ruby unpack phase that is executed once with system configured Ruby or the only Ruby supported package. And then during preparation phase, you first go through the all Ruby prepare, where you apply the patches that have to be applied to all the implementations, and then move on to apply patches specific for Ruby 1.8, 1.9, JRuby. You fix them as you need them to be fixed. Sometimes we have to remove a file, add a file, set the file to get it working with just one implementation, usually JRuby. We try our best not to make these changes because we prefer making the change one time and have it working with all of them so that we don't make implementation specific fixes, but sometimes it's needed. So we are also using Hans didn't cover this much, but we have two main interfaces for this setup. One is the RubyNG, that's the Niklas library for builds. RubyNG covers the execution of the multi-phases for multi-implementations. FakeGem is based upon RubyNG. It takes the defaults so that you can cover most of the details of a Ruby gem without having to set them at all. So for instance, in this case, this is a simple gem. It only has the list of implementations it works with. The documentation is present on that particular deal, in this case, the doc deal, since each gem has a different deal to get its API documentation. It can be doc, rdoc, yadoc. There is tons of different directories that are used. There is a simple variable to tell which files to install from the documentation of the gem, as well as the code of the gem. You have description, homepage. There is no source URI. Since all gems should be found on Ruby gems, if you don't set it explicitly, it will go looking for the name of the build file as the Ruby gem name and version directly on the Ruby gems repository. We usually override that with GitHub-based gems, builds for gems, because sometimes we have to take the tarball rather than the gem file itself because the tests are missing or the data files are missing. Then you have the usual stuff for Gentoo builds. Get to Mongoloid. Okay, we have here a newer, more complex build for Mongoloid. That's an active model wrapper for MongoDB. It's AAP4 and supports only one implementation right now because we are having trouble with the backend on Ruby 1.9. So that's a problem. We have sometimes, even if this gem is designed to work with Ruby 1.9, we are finding trouble with a dependency of this that doesn't work right or exactly as it should on 1.9. So we are not supporting this on 1.9 yet. We'll support it as soon as we fix, in this case, is Bison, the Bison implementation that is not working correctly on Ruby 1.9. In this case, there is no documentation installed, API documentation installed directly from the build because we can't rebuild it correctly. We don't run the usual test command. It's not a rake test in this case, but it's rake spec unit. We install some documentation, and there is this line here that tells us not to use the metadata fetched from RubyGem, but we instead get it from directly from the tarball itself. In this case, this one is a gem that has to be fetched from the GitHub because it doesn't work otherwise. It's missing some data. So we simply set these as only conveniences variables, and we set a Ruby S, so we don't have to care about the extension that the tarball from GitHub gives us, as it uses the small hash of the commit for a tarball. We tell it to fetch the data from GitHub. Go down. We add the dependencies for this build. Ruby at rdepend is used to apply the dependencies for the implementation, so that it will be running, will be requiring active model for the target that is selected. In this case, Ruby 1.8, because it doesn't support anything else. But if there are multiple implementations supported by the dependencies, it makes sure that there is the dependencies installed for that implementation, for the one we are looking for. Bdepend is for the build time dependencies, in this case, the test dependencies. And here starts trouble. Although we prepare, we condition the system, the sources, to work. We remove the references to bundler because otherwise we have trouble. Bundler is a tentative to fix Ruby dependencies handling, and it's making it more troublesome for us. So we remove any references to bundle, we remove the gem file, and we go on normally, down again. Then for test running, we have to start our own MongoDB instance. So in this case, you have a very complex function that is executed once for each Ruby target. Each Ruby target is executed in a different directory because this one will go, how can I tell, builds for native extensions, API documentation, most of the tests, dirty the directory. So you can't reuse it from Ruby 1.8 and 1.9. So each step for each function is executed in a different directory for each implementation. Then we simply call Ruby to execute Rake spec unit. Once we set up the whole MongoDB stuff, our main problems right now are handling of language bindings in external projects. So for instance, Vim bindings for Ruby and KDE binding for Ruby, because we haven't solved that problem yet at all. We have no way right now to build bindings for any project with Ruby 1.9, and we have to deal with that during this year, because we want to make Ruby 1.9 the default in Gentoo, since that's what Upstream is doing. And we have a trouble with Bundler. As I said, it's giving us more trouble than it should be solving, because not every gem spec, not every specification of a gem is providing the correct dependencies. So we have to either fix them or find a way around them, usually the former. We try our best to do the former, but sometimes Upstream is intentionally not specifying the correct dependencies in the gem spec files, so we have to get around them entirely, and that's quite a problem. That's all. You have any questions about packaging?
I'm employed by Mandriva as their RPM developer, and we have a pretty well, in my biased opinion, our Ruby packaging is quite very 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 nice, easy, state of the art, and yeah, no problem. Yeah, it's just very simple to maintain everything. But later on, when I was going to package newer versions of Gitorius, I noticed this new thing named bundles.
Bundler?
Yeah. And what the fuck? Do you how do you deal with this crap?
Yeah, okay. For Bundler, we solved it with Ruby Fake Gem, the library on top of the simple packaging for Gentoo. Ruby Fake Gem installs a specification on the disk with the dependency of the package, so that if a given library requires another three libraries, we make sure that the specification we install also lists those three dependencies. If
it won't like insist on, no, I really want to have my local copy.
Sorry?
No, but the most annoying thing with Bundler, I noticed, and if I wanted to care enough to fix it, I figured out that I had to modify a bundler to not insist on copying the gems locally.
Oh, bundler has actually, from a few versions back, a local option, bundler --local, for install and update, so it won't copy the file.
Oh, Okay.
But I solved that a few months back.
Okay.
Now it's much nicer to work with,
Okay. And
you only need to make sure that the specification of the gem installed in the system from the packaging system
Okay. Actually
represent the dependencies of the gem, as it only loads the libraries that are listed in their dependencies.
Personally, I just hate Ruby, but I would need it. And
Bundler 1.1, if I remember correctly, is the version that fixes it.
Okay. Yeah. And also, do you know if there are any plans to add a license tag to the metadata?
Sorry?
The meta, the gem.
Yeah, the metadata.
Yeah, it lacks a license tag.
I have suggested it to the Ruby gems developers before. They weren't much interested because it doesn't cover the use case.
They're the Ruby people.
You can try mobbing them for it. Probably they will do if it's not just me asking.
Yeah, because
that would be will be terrific for us to convert the Ruby gem in.
Because I found gem was a crappy packaging system. I hate Ruby, but the metadata made it. Okay. I can make these packages in in a second, and it's easy to automatically maintain by just generating the dependencies and all. So.
As I said, we have been having trouble with licenses because Rails prototype doesn't have a license, neither in metadata nor in the file. So we don't know which license to use for that.
Yeah.
Any more questions? Please raise your hand so I can see who has the question.
No other questions?
Okay, so that was all. Please, a big round of applause for them for doing the best they could.